Hello and welcome everyone to a brand new episode of Success Decoded podcast featuring success stories of entrepreneurs, investors and other individuals who have been there and done that in the startup world. So today we have come up with a podcast of a young successful entrepreneur, Mr. Harish Mohan, who is the founder and CEO of Sipwise Beverages Private Limited.
So my name is Harish Mohan and I have done my graduation in mechanical engineering from NIT Durgapur, and after that I have done stints in various industries. I worked for 5 years in TCS and then I've come back and worked with my mother in trying to run the Apollo Clinic. We have the franchise of the Apollo Clinic in Baroda. We ran that for about 1.5 years.
Okay.
Then I did my MBA from the Indian School of Business, Hyderabad.
Okay.
And following which I came back to work in a family business which deals with the distribution of pet food, poultry products, etc. And from there, the idea of doing what I did came into being, and post that I have been working in trying to set up Sipwise Beverages, and over the past 4 to 5 years I've been working in Sipwise Beverages itself.
Great qualification background, sir.
Thank you.
My next question is, what is the story, like what's the founding story and the important factors that made you go through the whole journey of reaching at the place where you presently stand?
So I think, you know, I'm not exactly qualified to speak on the topic of entrepreneurship or whether there is a magic formula to be an entrepreneur. But in my case, it was a mixture of both choice and circumstance. As it turns out, when I was doing my MBA at ISB, for about 3 months, I was at an exchange program at Duke School of Business. So I spent a lot of time in the pool and the recreational center there. And, you know, when I used to be done with my swim, etc., they used to offer these small $2 to $3 drinks, vitamin drinks, honey drinks, etc.
Right.
And I liked that idea. And I liked the idea that between water and your other nutrition, there is a space where you can also, you know, relax, have a good time with your drink, but also have something nutritious. And that seed was planted into my head, and once I came back to India, I tried to see whether there are drinks or products catering to this market. And at that time, there was this one. This is a very nascent market. But at that point of time, it had just kind of, the first seeds were there. So, and coincidentally, as it turned out, that through some relations, we also got into touch with an R&D firm who mentioned that they would have capabilities to build some products in the space.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, these both things came together to develop the journey to set up Sipwise Beverages. And we set about trying to, when I started off, the idea was to just, you know, try and develop beverages in the realm of functional beverages. That is, beverages that offer something more than taste, and they're fortified with natural ingredients and plant extracts. We started with that mandate, and over the course of 2.5 years, we developed a range of products called as green tea coolers, herb coolers, which was basically based on the mandate of developing new and novel drinks. And, you know, we are now at this journey where we are trying to develop the categories that we have made.
Great. And sir, as you mentioned, you have done your MBA from Hyderabad. So what was the specialization that you took?
I did my specialization in strategy and leadership.
Okay, great. Okay,
yeah.
So as you said that you're developing the categories that you are already into. So what are the basic and the most strategizing products that you offer?
Well, we offer a range of products right now. We offer something unique called as green tea coolers.
Yeah.
Where in one line the concept is all the benefits of green tea, none of the bitter aftertaste. Because what happens right now is that even though green tea is a niche product and is patronized by the health conscious crowd, a lot of people don't turn to green tea despite knowing its health benefits because it has a bitter taste. So we said, why not, or rather, what if we release a green tea that tasted as good as it sounded? So basically, that's the concept of you know, the green tea coolers that we offer. We fortified with ingredients like acerola, which is a rich source of vitamin C. In addition to that, we have this completely unique concept called herb coolers, where we mix herbs which we source from India and Germany and infuse it with vitamins, minerals, inulin, fruit powders, etc. and that's completely new category. Then we have an energy drink made out of natural ingredients, which we are positioning as 1947, the freedom to do whatever, whenever. So that's our energy drink, which has natural ingredients, less caffeine, a probiotic, etc. So these are our products that are there in the market right now.
Great. And so the next is, like, as we all know, like, as per the stats, the health and energy drink market in India is anticipated to grow around 5,000 crore by 2020. So in that case, what will be your strategic move regarding the same?
Well, of course, you know, we have to understand that in case what's happening in the beverage industry is that basically cola and soft drinks are having a degrowth. And the segments that are seeing double-digit growth are basically segments that we are in, fortified and functional beverages and energy drinks as well. Although energy drinks are poised to grow, you know, I do not particularly share the assessment. When you say health and energy drinks, that covers a lot of things. So when you say health and energy drinks, if Bonifra is included in that, then yeah, maybe that's the 5,000 crore market. But the energy drink in itself will not go to a 5,000 crore market. And having said that, there is space for an energy drink to grow and for a homegrown energy brand, the energy drink brand, that's what we are catering it. My assessment is that, you know, you could look at the market being at somewhere around 500 to 1,000 crores in 2020. That's how I would size the market as, yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, since you're running such a great, like you're running on such a great scale, what is the number of workforce that you manage currently?
We have a team of about 20 people. Basically, we have a sales team and then we have an R&D team. Our R&D team is almost as much as our sales team. We are right now in limited markets. We are there in Bombay, Pune, Bangalore, Goa, Chennai. Apart from the online channels, now that we are seeking to, we are getting into Delhi, NCR, Hyderabad, Gujarat, etc., the workforce is likely to increase going forward.
Okay, great. So the next, how do you advertise your business and products? Do you have a specific segment that you cater to?
So our segment, 25 to 40 years old segment of the youth, the segment of the millennials, the people with high disposable incomes, people who are willing to pay a premium for, you know, value offered in food and beverages, and people who are willing to try out new things and talk about it once they realize the value in it to other people as well. So this is a segment who we call as a conscious indulger.
Exactly, right. And what if you say that with disposable incomes, with like who are willingly there to spend on such products, right? So
yes.
Basically, what is the price of each product, like? What's the
beginning price? We have two brands, Waters and 1947.
Yes.
Waters is priced at 40 rupees for 200 ml.
Okay.
And 1947 is priced at 99 rupees for 250 ml.
Okay, great. So, yeah, the next one is, what is that one particular USP of your brand?
Our USP is natural ingredients and plant extracts for balance of health and taste. Fun yet refreshing, healthy yet refreshing, and we try. So our USP is the right balance through natural ingredients and plant extracts.
That's what we're lacking these days. Great. So the next one, do you use the services of any professional accountant or attorney?
No, we have a full-fledged finance team who manages all the accounts.
Okay, like in-house finance.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
Great. Okay.
Yeah.
Tell us about the fundraising part of the startup or any such plans to be amended in future.
Well, at this moment, we are funded through internal accruals of our parent company and we haven't raised funds. But the idea is to raise funds this year, and because we are seeking an almost 10x growth, and we have been approached by angel investors and VC firms, as well as we have approached a lot of these firms. So we are talking to some people, and we hope to raise funds in alignment with our growth strategy this year.
Okay. So, as you said that you approach to many angel investors and such venture capitalists. So, what is that one idea that drives them to basically, invest into your business? like that one thing that drives them, okay, this is the great thing that they wouldn't find in anything else, any other than this?
It's basically growth, volumes, what is the size of the market, how big is the market going to be in the next 5 years, what are you as a company going to do to capture a slice of the market, what is your differentiated advantage, how are you holding to that differentiating advantage. These are some factors that they consider.
Okay, great. Okay, so what is the annual sales amount you currently get and aim at getting by the end of 2019?
Well, we are at 1 crore right now, and we are, like I said before, that we are aiming for a 10x growth, and we want to touch the figure of 10 crores at the end of this year. Yeah.
Right. Okay. What is the company's long-term goal?
The long-term goal is to be a leader in functional beverages, carve out niches, offer out beverages for each particular functional area. So whether it be for slimming water, whether it be for hangover, whether it be for sports drink, the long-term goal is to be a house of brands as far as beverages is concerned, where each beverage is a smarter choice when it comes from the stable of that wine.
Great. Okay. So the next one, what are the major responsibilities as the owner of the brand?
Well, the major responsibilities as the owner of the brand is, first of all, the responsibility is to have a vision about what the brand is. It's both a responsibility and clarity. Clarity because you should be very clear in your head about what the brand is, what it stands for, and a vision because a responsibility and vision because taking that clarity, how do you want to basically create and enforce the values of the brand in the consumer segment? These are some things that you think about. From a marketing point of view, from a product point of view, it's very important to set the right quality standards to make sure that consumers expect the best quality from you. And these are things that, you know, subconsciously make the brand have a reputation in the market. So these are some things that you should be particularly looking after if you are a brand owner.
Great. Okay. So, last but not the least, what were the major challenges that you faced during the whole of your journey until now?
There are a lot of challenges. Initially, the challenge was in trying to get the right product. Once you develop the right product, the challenge was in trying to frame regulations that allow our product, because the product is novel in itself. If you got the product out in the market, there are sales channels, there are the supply channels, there are distribution channels, then there are, say, manpower issues. So these are some typical challenges that anybody will face when they are trying to get an idea up to its final stage of execution. And these are things that any entrepreneur or somebody who wants to set up a business should anticipate and preempt in his business plan.
Right. Okay, 3 days in your life looks like just as today is a Sunday, what does this look like?
Well, a Sunday is basically a God-given opportunity to kind of take a step back. But I also kind of utilize that Sunday to gain that perspective and have a bird's eye of the view of the business. So you're not completely away from work. For me, a free day is, just relaxing, spending time with pets, doing my own, looking after my own interests. Other interests. So I do feel that a balance between personal and professional work needs to be set, and that's why we have the concept of Sunday. So I do always believe that you should try and take a step back, because this is not everything in life.
Right. Great. And what are your hobbies?
I play squash. I love to trek. I am a big follower, I enjoy yoga. One of my idols is Rajiv Bajaj from Bajaj Auto, the man who has set up Bajaj Auto. So he talks a lot about how yoga is aligned to business. So I feel that a daily regimen of yoga also helps orient yourself in professional life as well. So these are some of my interests, and I also love to be in nature and in the presence of animals and things like that. Yeah.
Great. Okay, so who is your role model, like the biggest inspirer?
My role models are actually, like I mentioned, one of course is Mr. Rajiv Bajaj.
Right.
He's definitely my role model in the sense that, whenever I get stuck about what I want to do in a particular situation, or I feel that I'm not clear about a certain thing, I do turn to his YouTube videos, and where he talks a lot about, not all of his talk is about business, but it's also very practical common sense advice. So I believe in people who are able to, my role models are people who have the strength of clarity and keeping things simple. One of them is Mr. Rajiv Bajaj. I also admire MS Dhoni a lot, not for his cricketing prowess, but for his sense of intuition, calmness, and his ability to soak up pressure.
Right. Great. And so, yes, since you told us a lot many things about the product, about the brand and everything, as we know, there's a little content of sugar in everything. In every food or in every beverage or anything. So, is it totally okay for the people having diabetes to consume it, or is it a no for those people?
No, it is obviously a no for those people. Sugar is, as you have rightly said, it has become a villain in today's society, so is a large segment that people are staying away from sugar. We do recognize that, but having said that, if you look at the sugar content in our drink, they are the absolute minimum value. If you talk about a green tea, that has about 30-35% less sugar than comparable brands.
Okay.
If you talk about our herb coolers, the sweet, yes, we have a minimum amount of sugar, but we also have a natural sweetener called inulin. Going forward, having recognized the, if you look at the way the world is going, we do recognize that ultimately we do need to develop alternatives and substitutes for sugar. And we are working on it. And going forward, you are definitely likely to see variants from our company which are sugar-free and yet have all of these natural ingredients and yet taste good as well. Because the whole F&B industry is trying to find a good viable alternative for sugar, but they're not able to find an alternative that tastes as
sugar.
Or is as satiating as sugar.
Okay. And other than this, so you only have a national supply, or you even have cross borders?
Well, at this moment, we are only in the domestic market. We are definitely looking to get into the export market as well.
Okay, great. And so the last one now, any one or say two qualities or things that you would recommend for the entrepreneurs coming up? Anything?
I am not an entrepreneur by choice. I am an entrepreneur by accident. But I think being one by accident also gives a lot of insights into this whole world purely by the virtue of experience. So going by experience, I feel that any upcoming entrepreneur first of all has to make sure aspect is timing, is to make sure that you're timing your entry right. The second is basically the biggest challenge is also to find the right people in your team who are willing to come along with you and execute it for the vision. As an entrepreneur, you have to be you have to constantly and I also would say that you need to be energetic, you need to be open, you need to also realize that you will go wrong, and so you have to be okay with failure. You have to be okay with trying things.
Except negative. Yes,
except negatives, and you should. And when you're failing, also you should aim to fail small, and so that you can learn from those things, and then take bigger risks. So the idea should always be to, get into a project, try and see whether it works, and then take bigger risks. This is, of course, counterintuitive to today's modern day age growth story, where there are billion-dollar valuations in 2 to 3 years, etc. But this is my particular point of view that as an entrepreneur, again, this is one way of thinking. An entrepreneur can have multiple ways of thinking, but whatever your way of thinking is, you must have clarity and conviction in that idea. Because if you miss the basic gifts of clarity and conviction, you will never be able to convince everybody along in your journey, whether it be your team, whether it be your customers, whether it be anybody, so you must have clarity and conviction in your idea, and you must be able to articulate it properly.
Great, great. So how young were you when you founded this?
I was 19, so I was 30 years.
Oh, great. So great. You have come a long way when you were just 30.
Yes, I mean, it's been about 4 to 5 years. So we were still at the infancy stages of trying to develop a good product. So there is a long way to go. That's how I would look at it. But it's been an interesting journey so far.
Right, great. So, not being an entrepreneur, but I could really feel the rush while talking to you.
No, thank you, Mike. It was very nice for you to give me the opportunity as well.